Shalom, everyone. And the Nazarim, that's what we're called. There's something for the masses to see, and then there's something for the initiated to see. It's the darkness hiding in open view. We call them Wiccans, witches, warlocks, wizards, shamans. That's what they go by. It's poison doctrine.
Welcome to the circus.
Welcome, everyone, to the new seminar on the image of the beast today. And we're going to start off with the disciples' prayer that was taught to us, the pattern that we should use to pray to the Father. Our Abba, who is in Shamayim, Kodesh be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on Haaretz, as it is in Shamayim. Give us this yom, our daily lekem, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the honor forever and ever. Amen. And here's the seminar terminology. We're going to start off with this screen, and those of you that might be watching this on DVD, you can just pause it and study this and look these words up yourself, like particularly the word G-O-D. We were talking about that earlier. The word G-O-D was actually adopted into the faith when the belief came into the Norse areas, and this is actually a pagan term that was used for the deities of the Norse. And they adopted this term, just like you would adopt a child into your family. Well, this is a term that was used for pagan deities. A proper name, a proper name. And it's not that. We're going to use the Hebrew terms. That would be El or Elohim, which is a term that means strength, you know. Fundamentally, the strong one or mighty one. Yes?
I'm ready to say Elohim, the superior one.
Absolutely. Yeah, superior. Yeah. That would be, but the component in the Hebrew letters is Aleph Lamed, and it would mean strength, you know, strength under control. L-O-R-D, if you look that up, if you look in Webster's and you look under B-A-A-L, you'll see it's defined as Lord. And that isn't his name. His name is Hebrew. It's Yod Heh Uah Heh, Yahuwah. And the Messiah's name, of course, is Yahusha or Yahushua. That's used in the text both ways. 216 times it's spelled with five letters, Yahusha. And twice it's used in the Tanakh as Yahushua. And it means Yah is our deliverer. Now, the Yahudim are one tribe. That's the royal tribe. And it means worshipers of Yah. And, of course, they're named after their father, Yehuda, son of Yaakov. The Christians, this is a Greek term, we're going to call ourselves what we really are, the Nazarim, watchmen, the guardians of his name and his Torah. And we're branches also, that's what it means, as in the descendants of the teachings. See Jeremiah 31 verse 6 and particularly Acts 24 verse 5. That's where we're actually named. Yisrael are all the tribes, not just the Yahudim, that are descended from Yaakov, including the Yahudim, of course, and Benjamites. And those are living in the covenant. You know, if you're not in the covenant, then you're a Gentile. But once you engraft into the covenant, you're no longer a Gentile. You were a former Gentile, but you're an Israelite. The Nazarene are guardians and watchmen. Now, this is all part of the pieces of the restoration puzzle. Now, we're guardians of the name and the Torah, And there's the picture of the name in modern Hebrew letters, Yod, He, Uah, He, and the paleo letters. And there's also these Egyptianized type pictograms that many of you all have probably seen. But this is from Luke 11 that we just, you know, talked about the disciples' prayer. Kodesh be your name. That means set apart is your name. There's his name. And your will is to be done on earth. So those are the two things that we're guardian. His will, which is his Torah, his covenant. It's a marriage. Now the hoodwinking that we've been undergoing from the... Well, let's look at it like this. What if I told you that the enemy has a religious plan to deceive the world, and he does this by means of masquerading messengers of light, and they teach error to keep you away from the Torah, to keep you from the commandments, and they're basically warlocks, but they're deceivers, and they don't teach the Torah. They teach you to stay away from the Torah. That is obviously not Yahuwah's will. They've removed his name, and by changing it, they've used Greek and Latin to do so. So these deceived men are stumbling over the name, and they're saying, well, they don't know who we, they wouldn't know who we mean if we use the right name, so we're going to use the name they're traditionally used to. Well, that's a bad sign. His name is Hebrew, and Hebrew is the set-apart tongue. It's the set-apart language. And that's the language that all Scripture was inspired in. We shouldn't be afraid of it. We should actually be fond of it and have a love for it. Now here's the retelling of the covenant for the lost tribes, really the scattered tribes of Israel in the last days. This is given at Deuteronomy 5. And the first commandment given to us, if you read the context, if you read Deuteronomy 4, he says we're going to get scattered. And Deuteronomy 5, these are the words that will come upon us in the last days, in the latter days. Number one, I am Yahuwah your Elohim who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim, out of the house of bondage. You have no other mighty ones against my face. Number two, you do not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of which is in the heavens above or which is in the earth beneath or which is in the waters under the earth. You do not bow down to them nor serve them. For I, Yahuwah, your Elohim, am a jealous El, visiting the crookedness of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing kindness to thousands, to those who love me and guard my commands. Number three, you do not cast the name of Yahuwah, your Elohim, to ruin, for Yahuwah does not leave him unpunished who casts his name to ruin. The word cast is to lift up or to throw. And the word ruin is, of course, Shoah, utter destruction, to lay waste. And it's used, both of those terms are used twice in that commandment. The fourth commandment, guard the Sabbath day to set it apart as Yahuwah your Elohim commanded you. 6 days you labor and shall do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of Yahuwah your Elohim. You do not do any work, you nor your son nor your daughter nor your male servant nor your female servant nor your ox nor your donkey nor any of your cattle nor your stranger who is within your gates, so that your male servant and your female servant rest as you do. And you shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Mitzrayim, and that Yahuwah your Elohim brought you out from there by a strong hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore, Yahuwah your Elohim commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. And it's the covenant sign, if you read Yehezkel or Ezekiel chapter 20, sign of the everlasting covenant. Number five, respect your father and your mother as Yahuwah your Elohim has commanded you, so that your days are prolonged and so that it is well with you on the soil which Yahuwah your Elohim is giving you. Number six, you do not murder. Number seven, you do not break wedlock. Number eight, you do not steal. Number nine, you do not bear false witness against your neighbor. Number 10, you do not covet your neighbor's wife, nor do you desire your neighbor's house, his field, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, his ox, nor his donkey, or whatever belongs to your neighbor. Hear, O Yisrael, Yahuwah our Elohim, Yahuwah is one, And you shall love Yahuwah your Elohim with all your heart and with all your being and with all your might. And these words which I am commanding you today shall be in your heart, and you shall impress them upon your children, and shall speak of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up, and shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes, and you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Now the living words that we just read is the Torah, the instructions. That's what the word Torah means. And it involves an everlasting covenant. And it was once written in stone tablets. And now, as of the recorded actions of Acts chapter 2, it's written in men's hearts now. So we actually love the commandments. Psalm 37 says, "Turn away from evil and do good and dwell forever. For Yahuwah loves right ruling and does not forsake his kind ones. They shall be guarded forever, but the seed of the wrongdoers is cut off. The righteous shall inherit the earth and dwell in it forever. The mouth of the righteous speaks wisdom, and his tongue talks of right ruling. The Torah of his Elohim is in his heart. His steps do not slide." Now, we are going to cover a topic today that's going to be really sad to show you, but it's going to be important that you understand this is part of the last restoration pieces, and it's breaking down strongholds. See, strongholds are mental fortresses that people have taken into their body, put into their lamp, in their heart, and they've accepted them as truths. And some of them are visual images, and some of them are patterns of our images or types of models. And those things have to be broken down. We have to tear down those strongholds when they're not true. Now, over here you see a stop sign with a cross symbol on top of it. And it's important that when we see a certain sign, that we stop when we see a dangerous situation. Now, if these signs that we see, we just read the commandments, if it says to not work on the Sabbath, and we ignore that, then we could have a train wreck at some point in the future. Because if somebody evil moved the sign from that roadway, that crossing, and they moved it somewhere else and said, "No, we just moved this one road up." Well, that's what they did with the days. They took the Sabbath and they moved it one day so that the people that are crossing the dangerous zone of where they should be stopping, they have an accident. They're going to have an accident. But signs have to be accurate. And the sign of the Sabbath is very, very serious, because it's the sign between the children of Israel and Yahuwah forever. Now, what if the signs are not accurate? Now, Psalm 119 is one of my favorite psalms, if not the most favorite psalm. And it says, "I have thought upon my ways and turned my feet to your witnesses." And he's speaking of the commandments, because Yahuwah's witnesses are his commands. Now, this, I'm going to give you a caution here. This is a paradigm collapse trauma that's going to occur in some people here. People's whole world is going to be shattered when they see certain things. What is the sign of the true belief? Most Christians would say it's the cross. That's the sign, because that was given to them by Constantine and other councils that followed that. But these patterns and symbols may not be what you think they are. Now, a sign is a signal. It's a sign or a mark or a beacon or a logo or a brand, like a cattle brand, marking the ownership of someone. It's also a witness or indicator. And what sign did Yahuwah endorse? And we're going to ask that question. The sign of the menorah. That was the sign that he endorsed. It's not made by men. What is the beast? Well, the beast, remember, there's two levels of Hebrew. There's the concrete, and then there's the abstract. So the beast was shown in an abstract way to Daniel in a dream that Nebuchadnezzar actually had first. And that image was a head of gold and chest and arms of silver and bronze and iron and clay. That's an abstract image of the beast. Now, what was the image of the beast 4,000 years ago? Well, we're going to find out. The beast is Babylon. It's Babel. That's what it is. It's the pattern of Babel. And at the center of that is an anti-Messiah, and his name is Tammuz. We talked about that just before the seminar began. What was that question that you asked me?
I said, I forgot it.
You've forgotten the question?
Yeah.
Well, you asked me a very important question, and that question involved, you know, who is the anti-Messiah, you know? And the anti-Messiah is actually Tammuz. He's the one whose head was injured. He was the one whose head was injured, a fatal wound, and the wound was healed. I know that sounds really fresh and new to most of you, but think about it as the seminar progresses. And you're going to see Tammuz is all over the place. The anti-Messiah is a pattern. It's not a person in the sense right now. There will be many anti-Messiahs, yes, that will be people. But they will be resisting the truth and diverting you away from the Torah. But the pattern of the anti-Messiah started with Tammuz. And remember, he was slain by a boar, and then they wept and weep for him. That's what Lent is. Lent is a Babylonian deity. Tammuz is a Babylonian deity. Anyway, and so there was a resurrection even then, you know. Now, has your conscience been seared as with a hot iron? 1 Timothy verse 4, or 1 Timothy chapter 4. Now, a man named Ludwig Borne said, losing an illusion makes you wiser than finding a truth. Well, I don't know if that's necessarily always true, but it's a man's words, and they kind of make sense. But another man who was into Spiritism, Arthur Conan Doyle, once said that when you are looking for the truth, once you've eliminated everything that's impossible, whatever is left, however improbable, is the truth. Now that's what we're going to discover here too. If you can overcome the false teachings, you can actually change your brand. Remember, we've been branded with thoughts and ideas that are strongholds, you know, ideas that we have to obey, but we really don't. Now, a stronghold is a mental fortress, such as Sunday, or E-A-S-T-E-R, or the true name is not a stronghold, but the resistance to the true name, using the false names, that's a stronghold. And symbols, and the fact that we think that there's people lording or mastering over us, conquering the people, Nicolaitanes. 2 Corinthians 10 says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not fight according to the flesh. For the weapons we fight with are not fleshly, but mighty in Elohim for overthrowing strongholds, overthrowing reasonings, and every high matter that exalts itself against the knowledge of Elohim, taking captive every thought to make it obedient to the Messiah, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is complete. Now, in John chapter 8, or Yehukinan chapter 8, starting at verse 31, it says, so Yahushua said to those Yahudim who believed in him, if you stay in my word, you are truly my taught ones, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. You know, the strongholds are the thing that's holding you in. You're doing it to yourself. The truth overcomes deceptions, and false beliefs are what imprison us. So this is a seminar on the image of the beast. Now, let me explain again. Hebrew and the ideas of Hebrew have a concrete meaning that you can physically touch and see with your eyes. And they also have an abstraction or an idea attached to them as well. Like the image that was shown to Nebuchadnezzar in the dream. That was the image of the beast, but it was an abstraction. It wasn't a physical thing. But there was a physical thing that was made. If you read the early chapters of Daniel, you'll see there was an image that was put up that they had to bow to. Okay? Hebrew words have these two levels. An image is a resemblance, either physical or organizational in form of the beast. The beast is Babylon and the Babylonian pattern. Now, a reflection of the beast by representation, resemblance, or pattern, and it's any representation, physical or abstractly, of Babel. And it's become mixed in various ways into the world. Now, listen to this in Ezekiel chapter 8. And he said to me, Son of man, lift up your eyes toward the north. And I lifted my eyes northward, and north of the altar I saw this image of jealousy in the entrance. Okay? Entrance. Okay, what you're going to see some things that you've probably never seen before. But there was an image that was there. It was an image of jealousy. And Nebuchadnezzar erected one of these things. And it was a sun pillar, some people have called it. It's a phallus. It's an image of sexual regeneration. But it's actually a huge monument to this Babylonian thing, you know, and it went into all the world. Now, at the top, you see the image of an Egyptian eagle. Then you see a Roman eagle, and you see the Nazis adopted this too, because they were trying to start the Fourth Reich, or the Third Reich. And that wreath is in both of those, as well as the eagle. When the faith became backed by the power of the Roman state, all the pagans joined in, bringing with them their pagan and familiar trappings. When you think about this, imagine the real followers, the Nazarene, or the followers of Messiah, dressing up like this. Who dressed up like this? Well, the people who dressed up in all these hats and gowns and robes and had all this gold and stuff, those were the pagan priests. When the faith mixed together with Rome and the state backed them and had all their wealth and their authority, the Nicolaitans took over. And the pagan priests called themselves by the same terms that we find in the scriptures, but only more Greek. But this is a picture of a pagan priest. That's the way they looked all before Messiah ever even came to the earth. And in the temples of the pagan priests, they would, have eagles and all their images. And this other image that we call the image of Peter was actually the actual image of the sun deity. And they renamed the statue. Anyway, here's some things that they did. They took on pagan priestly garments. They adopted distinguishing symbols and rank. And they took on ceremonial processions. That's what the pagans did. They adopted all the pagan holidays. And, of course, Constantine's hatred of Israel and their commanded holidays were completely wiped clean. Symbols like obelisks and crosses, holy water, statues, and chants. And these are all abominations, you know. Now, up at the top right, you'll see an image of jealousy at an entrance, like we mentioned on the last page. An image of jealousy that Ezekiel or Yehezkel looked at, that Yahuwah showed him and said, you see this? At the entrance to a pagan temple in Luxor. Luxor is in Egypt, or Mitzrayim. And it's down on the Nile on the east side of the river. And Luxor is filled with all these, basically, images and temples. But there it is. There's an image. Everybody can see that. It's an obelisk. The pillar of jealousy. Ezekiel 8 says, and see, the esteem of the Elohim was there, and like the vision that I saw in the plain. And he said to me, Son of man, lift up your eyes toward the north. And I lifted my eyes northward, and north of the altar gate I saw this image of jealousy in the entrance. Well, there it is. You know, I mean, this isn't the one that Ezekiel saw. This is in Luxor. But that's what they put there. And that pattern that came from Babylon, of course, went into Persia and brought itself to Egypt and Rome. And you'll see that they brought some of these objects and put them at the entrances. Now, pay attention to that, because they're always at the entrances of the pagan temples. The image of jealousy borrowed from Babel, used at Luxor, Egypt, at the entrance. Now, here's an old image of the beast. We're going to come back to that, but just keep that in your mind. The image of the beast 4,300 years ago in Sumer, or Chaldea, was this little nazed out looking circle with the cross symbol coming out of it. I mean, that's a fact. That's what they worship. And here's an incense burner showing that symbol on it. It's a Sumerian incense burner. Now, a Franciscan friar named Occam, that's William of Occam, Occam's razor, he was a Franciscan friar. He said the simplest explanation for any or for some phenomenon is more likely to be accurate than more complicated explanations. Okay? Now, this is a simple explanation. It's all it is. It's not hiding behind anything. It's not making anything complicated. It's just showing you the truth. This is what it was. Now, what happens if we look at the image of the beast in Daniel's time, 2,590 years ago? Now, remember, the image abstractly is the statue that was shown to Nebuchadnezzar in the dream. That's the abstract. But the physical one, the physical component, was actually an object. 2,590 years ago in Daniel's time, the image was the sun pillar. Bam, there it is. Now, what happens if we combine these two images into one? Just what happens? It can't be an accident. Now, think about that, and think about that, and then put them together, and what do you got? Oh, what do you know? Well, that's kind of scary. And I know that the reasoning behind all these things have been changed, but that's the way they do everything. When a Hebrew would go into a pagan land, the first thing the rulers would do is say, well, we can't be using that word for your name. We're going to be changing your name. We can't be using that name. So they changed the names of all these people. Like Daniel, his name was changed, and all of his little buddies. And when Yosef went into Mitzrayim, you know, as a captive, and then he was lifted up to become the second in charge of the whole land, they changed his name. Now, it's like a fine wine or a tasteful blend of Egypt and Sumer, in Sumerian sun worship. This Egyptian obelisk, the very one that you're looking at on the screen here, is standing in the center of the entrance of St. Peter's in Rome. At the entrance. Remember I mentioned entrance before? Well, this is the same pillar that was quarried 1300 BCE, sometime around the time, they aren't really sure about these dates, it could be 100 years off or even 200 years off. Most likely is. But it was moved from Alexandria in Egypt to Rome in the first century. Now, in the first century, who do you suppose it was that moved it to Rome? It wasn't Christians. It was pagans. Pagans moved this object from a seat of Satan's rulership to Satan's new seat in Rome. So one reason may be that Satan's seat moved to Rome in the first century. You know, and it had nothing to do with Christians or Nazarene. Nazarene certainly wouldn't do that. Okay? Now, in 1586, this same pillar was moved 275 yards and erected in front of the Vatican so it would be there near the entrance. There it is. Note the Hindu wheel of life down there that it's patterned after. And look at this thing over here with the Ankh over here on this statue. And then notice the similarity in the Cairo symbol, the X, the wreath, the crux. That thing was around 200 to 300 years BCE. So how in the world could that get adopted into Christianity? Well, it was. Is that a mere coincidence? Now, these are physical objects, but remember, there's a physical and abstract level. Acts 7, Stephen is talking to the Sanhedrin. He says, so Elohim turned and gave them up to worship the host of the heaven, as it has been written in the book of the prophets. Did you bring slaughtered beasts and offerings unto me during 40 years in the wilderness, O house of Israel? And you took up the tent of M-O-L-E-K and the star of your mighty one, K-I-Y-Y-U-N, images which you made to bow down before them. Therefore I shall remove you beyond Babel. Now, remember, a lot of people have interpreted this, and a lot of teachers have told you that this is the Star of David. Many of you are convinced of that. No one has ever bowed to the Star of David. That has never happened, and it is never going to happen. And yet, they do bow to another kind of star. That's the star that they've been bowing to, and that's the same star they always have bowed to and always will. Now, the sign of the Chaldean religion is an image, the Hebrew word selim, and it's a resemblance or representation of the object they worship, and that's the sun. Now remember, the sun is what the pagans ultimately worshipped, and that's this part of the reason the Latin term for the adversary is light bringer, Lucifer. Well, that's who's behind the whole scheme. The Star of Bethlehem is depicted as a solar crux in this stained glass window. It's exactly like this thing over here. You know, it's exactly the same. Images of Babel and Christianity are presented here side by side. You can see the image right there with the steeple with the cross on top and a circle down here with a cross inside of it. Now, pay attention to that. How are we doing? Okay. Now, the Sumerian crux with the obelisk, picture it on top of it. See the crux on top of the obelisk. And then there's a crux on top of this obelisk. And this is a drawing of the representation of the Roman deity that Augustus Caesar worshipped. His name was Gaius Octavius. But Augustus Caesar worshipped the sun, as did Constantine. But this is the image that they have. Now, you see any resemblance there? Exactly. It's the same. And he was called various names. One of them was Apollo. He was the sun deity of Rome. And Augustus Caesar was the one that, gave us the, he's mentioned in the scriptures. Now, here we have an image of a sun kind of representation with a cross on top of it. And this is something that's linked to Constantine's vision of his sun deity, Apollo. Now, the origin of the monstrance, which is an object that the Catholics have, or really the Roman Catholics, are Roman, so they understand that the host, which is a sun disk of bread, is placed in this object, and it looks like a sunburst with a cross on top. And it's actually made for worship. Okay? The image of the beast, and people bow down to this image, and they sit there and meditate and kneel before this. And the image of the sun is shown with the symbol of Tammuz on top of it. Now, we're going to understand that the image of Tammuz is related to this. We mentioned Tammuz earlier. It's the mystic Ta, the Babylonian letter T. And benediction is giving thanks and respect and praise, obeisance and worship of the host of heaven. They even call it a host. I mean, they don't even change the word at all. They just say, yeah, it's a host. Is there not a lie in my right hand? I thought that was a funny thing because I took a text out of scripture where the people, I'll get to that text and you'll remember this scene. Anyway, there's those images. Now, this is a local man here in Louisville, Kentucky, named the Archbishop. And I'm not attacking him personally. I'm just saying that this is a type of drunkenness that we have to deal with. But he's talking to little children in this picture, and he's using Constantine's symbol of his deity, Apollo, that, of course, has been all reinvented. And he's saying, any questions? And then the little boy says, are you brainwashed, or are you just pretending? Anyway, these people, they're all deceived. They don't know that they're warlocks. They have no clue. If you told them they were warlocks, they'd probably be offended. You know? But, we have to pray for them to be released from this stronghold by the revelation of the truth. You know, we don't need to adopt pagan ways. In fact, Yahuwah is on record saying, you shall not worship me in their way. Don't do it. The sign of the true faith, is it a cross? Well, yeah, according to the Christian teachings, for the last, 1,200 or more years. No, more than that. Yeah, it's more like 1,500 plus years. Where did the cross come from? Well, we already know that. We've learned that today. When did it become associated with the Mashiach of Yisrael? When did that happen? And who did it? Was Yahusha actually hung on a cross or a stake? Well, yeah, one of them, but not both. Has someone pulled the wool over your eyes? This is a symbol that a lot of you all probably recognize. This is where they put ashes on the foreheads, the symbol of Tammuz on the foreheads. It's pretty crazy. Now, Yahusha described the specific mechanism. In Yahuchanan or John chapter 3, it says, that means exactly in the same way, not kind of like it, but exactly this way. As Moshe lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so, the Son of Adam has to be lifted up, so that whoever is believing in him should not perish, but possess everlasting life. And of course, that's because not of the belief that they have necessarily, but because of the great sacrifice. Because it isn't the object that he was on that matters. It's what was on that object. And that blood is the thing that makes you not able to be perishing. Because you're trusting in his blood. That's the thing that is covering your sins. The blood covers your sins, and you trust in that. In Numbers chapter 21, we hear about this thing called Nehushtan, which is the serpent. And Yahuwah said to Moshe, make a fiery serpent, or a seraph, that's the actual word there, and set it on a pole. That's the Hebrew word, nas. And it shall be that everyone who is bitten, that's the bite of sin, when he looks at it, shall live. So Moshe made a bronze serpent, nakash, and put it on a pole. That's the word nas. It didn't put it on a cross. And it came to be, if a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. So the Hebrew word is H5251, nas, and it's spelled nun samach, and it means pole, a flagstaff, or a mast. A mast. Like, what's, there's a boat. Oh, well, that's the same kind of object. It's just a pole that goes up above, and it's got a purpose. Now, the Greek words, which really shouldn't matter, but there's two words that are identical in meaning, and one is zulon, and that means wood or a post, and staros. Now, staros is the word most often used in the text, even though zulon is also used interchangeably, meaning they're the same. For 1,600 years now, beginning around 400 CE, the world has been conditioned to accept a visualization that has not only been inaccurate, but it is an abomination in the eyes of our Creator. It's amazing that the very object that is most cherished is actually, in His eyes, an abomination. And I'll show you why that's an abomination. I'm going to explain that using His words. For 1,200 years prior to the Protestant Reformation, the Latin Vulgate was considered to be inspired, and the prize translation, much like the King James Version, is cherished today. So for 1,200 years, the Latin Vulgate was cherished. Okay? Sometimes we hear someone say, if the King James Version was good enough for the apostles, it's good enough for me. Now, the Latin Vulgate was rendered 300 plus years beyond the lives of the first followers of Yahusha, and in the language of those who carried out his death. That's Latin. The ones that carried out his death were the Roman soldiers of Rome, Italy. Now, what would this picture look like to Yahusha's followers in the first century? They wouldn't even know what they were seeing, but they would know that there was something very wrong. But when we're conditioned improperly, then we see this as something very nice. Just like when we hear the word Sunday, when we're blinded, we think, yes. Well, oddly enough, that's not good. Now, when Eusebius Hieronymus Sophronius, who they call Jerome, translated the Greek text into Latin, which is called the Vulgate, He chose a word that did not match with what the Latin already had as a perfect parallel word. All right, I'm going to explain that to you. He already had a word that was exactly the same. The Greek word for the object that Yahusha carried and was nailed to is staros. Okay, the Latin word for this term is staro. It's the same word. The ST, staro, the ST component is the root and gives the meaning of any upright pole as we see reflected in other etymologically related words. Post, staff, stave, stick, strut, mainstay, stalk, stump, stake, mast, and so on. Etymologically, these are all related. These words, post, staff, stick, mainstay, stalk, in a thesaurus, they relate to one another. But crux or cross is not mentioned in the thesaurus. You can look up staff or stick, you won't see cross. And if you look up cross, you will not see these terms. They're not related. Now, Constantine and Jerome, later in that century, continued in the trend of the catechetical school at Alexandria, which is in Egypt, by blending and syncretizing the ancient symbols and ideas of Babel. Now, you can view a video on YouTube called the Nazarene documentary for more information about the catechetical school at Alexandria. Now, the crux represents 1,200 years of tradition based upon error. And the Vulgate, or the Latin translation, erred, okay? The Greek word staros is used nowhere in the Septuagint. The same equivalence of that is the word zoulon, and it consistently uses the word zoulon, which is not a cross. But it is the same word as staros. Okay? Now, the Septuagint does not use the word staros at all. It uses the word zoulon. That's the word in the Greek. The Greek word staros properly signified a stake or an upright pole, a mast, a stick, a staff, or a wood fencing stake, like they'd use in a little wood fort, you know, a stockade. Even the word stockade has the ST in it. Homer, okay, 1,000 years BC, Homer. The Greek dude, about 1,000 years before the time when the Gospels were written, used the word staros of an ordinary pole or stake or a single piece of timber. And this was the meaning and usage of the word throughout the Greek classics, 4 or 5 centuries before the time of the Gospels. In the literature of that time, it never means two pieces of timber placed across one another at any angle, but always one piece alone. Cross, first used by Jerome in translation in the year 391 through 403. Now that's odd. The Latin word, the equivalent word for staros is staro. He didn't use that word. He had an agenda. The Latin word directly associated with the Greek staros was ignored, and crux was used instead. And of course, they fabricated all these ideas that, oh yeah, well, that's the way the Romans executed all their prisoners. They did it this way. No, they didn't. Actually, when you dig deeply enough, there's a volume, 400-plus page book on the research of how they really did it. They would display the dead bodies up on poles in various ways. Like when they nailed King Shaul's body to the wall. Well, they put him up for display that it was already dead in most of the cases. Yes.
Probably getting way ahead here, but in the scriptures where it says, take up your cross and follow me, that was the word originally zoulon.
It was staros in that text, yes. But we're going to look at that, and I did like the fact that you brought that up, because we're going to look at that very carefully. In the companion Bible, our buddy Ethelbert William Bullinger, very intelligent theologian that lived during the Civil War period. In Appendix 162, this is a direct quote, so please excuse the terminology. In the Greek New Testament, two words are used for the cross, on which the Lord was put to death. Number one, the word staros, which denotes an upright pale or stake, to which criminals were nailed for execution. The word zulon, which generally denotes a piece of dead log or of wood or timber for fuel or any other purpose. Now, as this latter word zulon is used for the former word staros, it shows that the meaning of each is exactly the same. Homer uses the word staros of an ordinary pole or stake. Bullinger is an amazing guy. He had realized a lot of these things, and he put them in the appendixes because he basically went down the line with the King James and analyzed it, but he printed it the way it was, but then he explained the errors that were in it, which is really cool. Words like E-A-S-T-E-R, he explained that was an error, you know. Now, the origin of crosses, you can see these images up here. This is an image of Tammuz, who we talked about, the anti-Messiah, the Babylonian anti-Messiah, and the sun crosses. It's all based on Sumerian sun worship, rebellion against Yahuwah. And Tammuz was the son of Shemiramis, the wife of Nimrod, and he's basically the anti-Mashiach, the pattern of the anti-Mashiach. I don't want you to think he is. It's the pattern. Tammuz is reflected in the origin of Lent. The lengthening of days in the springtime is referred to by the word Lent, which means lengthening. And the mourning of Tammuz for 40 days was over his death from being struck by a boar. So the mystic Ptah is actually an image of Tammuz, and it's been reflected from the very dawn of history all the way through Babylonian format. Now, the entry point for mixed worship in this symbol came from the Egyptian use of the word, it's a crux ansata. The crux ansata, that means the Egyptian sign of life. It means a handled cross, a cross with a handle on it. That's what crux ansata means. Now, in the Encyclopedia Britannica, the 11th edition, volume 14, page 273, we read, in the Egyptian assemblies, the cross was a pagan symbol of life, borrowed by the Christians, adopted, interpreted in the pagan manner. Jacob Grimm, in his Deutsche Mythology, says that the Teutonic or Germanic tribes had their idol THOR, symbolized by a hammer, while the Roman Christians had their crux. It was thus somewhat easier for the Teutons, that's the Norse tribes, to accept the Roman cross. Here we have a picture of an old drawing of a pagan with the symbol of the Ankh.
Now that Ankh was really a fertility sex symbol.
It was. It was a symbol, and it's adopted in the garments of the bishops and the Pope. Yeah, the pallium or pallium. Yeah, the pallium, and it's a symbol of. Yeah. Yeah, it symbolizes sex. That's because the pagan temples were operational centers for worship through sex. You know, the temple prostitutes, male and female. And the priests were wearing the objects that symbolized those things. Now, the universal symbol of the beast, as far as a physical symbol, is adopted also in the Cairo. The Cairo being two letters in Greek, the Chi, and the row, it looks like a P, but it's really a row. The image of the Cairo is on a coin of Ptolemy III from the year 247 through 222 BC. The Labarum is what it's called, is an emblem of the Chaldean Babylonian sky deity, and in Christianity it was adopted, taken in as an adopted child, okay, by Emperor Constantine as the imperial ensign, and thereby succeeded in uniting both divisions of his troops, pagans and Christians, in a common worship. So the logo of the pagans was taken in. The sign of Tammuz, the mystic Ptah of the Babylonians and Egyptians, was mixed into the faith by Constantine. If you had to guess in a multiple choice question which one did it, I mean, it'd be pretty easy. And it has since been adored, in other words, worshipped, and all the homage due to only the Most High. Another dictionary relates the following about the Cairo. quote, however, the symbol was in use long before Christianity, and Chi probably stood for great fire or sun, and Rho probably stood for pater or patah, meaning father. The word labarum yields everlasting father son. Now, there's no record of any use of a cross until the 4th century. That's a fact. No doubt the influence of Constantine and his worship of Apollo, the sun. His deity gave him the sign of the crux beneath the sun with the words, in this sign conquer. Now, interestingly enough, he was shown a sign twice in his career. But he was praying to his sun deity, Apollo, and then he looked up and he's looking in the direction of the sun, and he sees a cross and the words, in this sign conquer. That's messed up. And now this warlock is over here suggesting something. We better pay attention. Show them the monstrance. Okay, you see this stuff we've been looking at. Constantine worshipped Apollo, the sun, as did Augustus Caesar or Gaius Octavius. In hoc signo vinces, in this sign you will conquer. The historian Eusebius says that Constantine looked up to the sun and saw a cross of light above it, and with it the Greek words. Now this is Eusebius. I didn't write this. Eusebius wrote this. He's the historian, you know, that wrote down all the activities of Constantine. And he saw this thing, and he saw the Greek words, in tauto nika, by this be victorious. And it's rendered often as in hoc signo vinces. And here's the Pope over here showing you, was it something like this? Well, there's the monstrance, and there's the quote, you know, boing, you know. Now, this is kind of sad, too. We have all these poor soldiers and people living in they're dead, they're in cemeteries, and they're under the ground, and they've been marked with these symbols. Of course, to them, it didn't mean this. That doesn't mean that to me. What does it look like to Yahuwah, though? That's the main thing. In this sign, conquer. Well, the conquering is being done by the adversary, really. But the image of Tammuz is right there. And in Revelation 14, look at these words and how they relate to this. This is going to be kind of creepy. And I saw another messenger flying in mid-heaven, holding the everlasting good news to announce to those dwelling in the earth, even to every nation and tribe and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear Elohim and give esteem to him, because the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and the fountains of water. And another messenger followed, saying, Babel is fallen, that great city, because she has made all the nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her whoring. And a third messenger followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast and his image and receives the mark on his forehead or upon his hand, he also shall drink of the wine of the wrath of Elohim, which is poured out undiluted into the cup of his wrath, and he shall be tortured with fire and sulfur before the set-apart messengers and before the Lamb. So the esoteric magic symbol of the sun was also seen in various places before Christianity even got there. Look at this. This is a shocking discovery made in the 1500s. When the Spanish missionaries set foot upon the soil of America, that they mean probably, you know, the North and South American continent, in the 15th century, they were amazed to find the cross was devoutly worshipped by the Red Indians as by themselves. Now, pay attention to what that's saying. That's saying not only was the cross already here as a symbol that they worshipped, but it says that they were worshipping it too. It says, worship by the Red Indians as by themselves. So anybody that says they don't worship it, well, there's a lot of history that says they do. And they were in doubt as to whether to ascribe the fact to the pious labors of St. Thomas or the cunning device of the evil one. I don't think that Thomas would have done this. The hallowed symbol challenged their attention on every hand and almost every variety of form. It appeared on the base reliefs of ruined and deserted, as well as on those of inhabited palaces, and was the most conspicuous ornament in the great temple of Gozumel off the coast of Yucatan. There's a Sumerian thing, yeah, it's right there in the middle, and there's the Incan, and there's the Andean. Ah, that's too creepy. Now, and here's a whole bunch more for you, for your viewing enjoyment. Anyway, the Peruvians would worship this stuff like this. There's a sun deity that looks a lot like this fella. There's that Hindu the Nazis adopted. There's a Mayan calendar, but it's not so much different either. But then there's this, and then there's the Sumerian thing. Then there's the Celtic crooks, and there's African masks and other things, shields and things, that have these mysterious crosses on them that have nothing to do with even Alexandria, Egypt, really, you know. But there's a wheel of life, the Hindu wheel of life. And this is a gentleman who is a deceased Catholic that was very noteworthy. His name was Thomas Merton. A lot of people respect him. Now, he was born in 1915 and he died in 1968. A Trappist monk of the Abbey of Gethsemane, Kentucky. So he's a fellow that lived right nearby too. In the 20th century, he printed this book called A Seven-Day Journey with Thomas Merton. And he's quoted as saying this, "I see no contradiction between Buddhism and Christianity. I intend to become as good a Buddhist as I can, and yet remain a Christian." Well, that's odd, because most people would say on the face of that sounds really, really conflicted. But really, it's not, because that's what it is. It's just using a term for the same thing. He was too drunk to see that both were based on the worship of Tammuz from Babel. The Celtic cross, or Ionic cross, has its root in pre-Christian variation of the solar cross. The origin of the Celtic cross are not clear, but it was known to be an early symbol of the Gaelic sun deity, Taranis. After the conversion of the Celtic people to Christianity, the Celtic cross became an emblem of the Celtic Christian corps, or C-H-U-R-C-H, or circus. Sorry. Anyway, the word C-H-U-R-C-H, maybe many of you haven't been exposed to it, but you need to find out where that word really came from. It's actually first appearing in the Geneva translation, and it was actually intending to be the word congregation, you know. But for Nicolaitan reasons, they used this. The solar cross is probably the oldest religious symbol in the world. Did you read that? The solar cross is probably the oldest religious symbol in the world, and it appears in Asian, American, European, and Indian religious art from the dawn of history. Composed of equal armed cross within a circle, it represents the solar calendar, the movements of the sun, marked by the solstices. Sometimes the equinoxes are marked as well, giving an eight-armed wheel. Okay? The swastika is also a form of the solar cross, originating in Hinduism. Now, here's a little happy little wood-carved head of a bull with crosses on it. Before Christianity existed, this is Minoan. Now, there's a happy little feather-dancing Native American guy. He's got a cross. But they call him the Great Spirit, you know. And there's the Mayan. And there's the Zoroastr. And how would you explain this to an alien? Well, don't worry about those totem poles, because people worship those too, you know. Cross adoration. I'm not trying to make fun of the people, but I'm saying, look at what they're doing. I'm just showing you what they're doing. You know, it's sobering. Now, they smell the bitter stench of wormwood, and it's clearly shown on their faces. Look at these people. It's like something's really seriously wrong here. 1 Kings 19 says this, "Yet I have reserved 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth which has not kissed him." So the kissing of the deity is very, very important to these people. And remember, B-A-A-L is Hebrew for L-O-R-D. What's the sign of the true belief? Okay, well, we remember the sign of the true belief is actually the menorah, which is a symbol of the Torah. But who taught us to do this? You know, they're kissing these cross symbols. And here's the same image that was in the temple of APOLLO that Augustus Caesar went to worship. Augustus Caesar put a bell in the tower at the entrance of this deity's temple. Okay? Gaius Octavius, who was known as Augustus Caesar. This is the same object that he went in and looked at and probably bowed down to himself. He might have even kissed that thing. You know, and probably did. He was a very devout worshiper of the sun deity. And another word for this deity is J-U-P-I-T-E-R. And it's a statue that they adopted, took it in as their own, and said, yeah, this is not that name anymore. It's now Peter. That's who it is. And this is just craziness. But they appear either drunk or walking in their sleep. I don't think that Yahusha instructed anybody to take a pagan deity, rename it, and then kiss its foot. Now here's the symbol of the Torah, the symbol, the emblem given to Israel, and it's a menorah, and it's shown in Rome inside the Ark of Titus, the conquering general that actually wrecked Jerusalem. And it's shown there, and it's celebrating the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 CE. Now, the Torah is the light of the world, and its emblem is, of course, a thing that gives light. It's a lampstand with seven lamps on it. The menorah points to the Torah, and the Torah points to the sign, which is the Sabbath. And there's seven branches there, an emblem of something we're supposed to think about, the week. Talking to fishermen. Now, this is something that our gentleman, that I think he had to step out, but this is exactly addressing the text that he talked about. When Yahusha was talking to his disciples, he was talking to people who were fishermen, and they understood things that we might not understand in the same way. But here's an idiom, or look at the way it's said. Was he using nautical language when he was speaking to these fishermen? Well, probably. Matthew 16, verse 24 says, then Yahusha said to his taught ones, if anyone wishes to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his staros and follow me. Now, let's analyze that word take up. That's in the Greek, it's the word aero. That's A-I-R-O. And it means to raise up. But it has an idiom in the lingo to a fisherman. And that lingo, it means to cast off, anchors away. It means let's get launched. It's boat talk. You know, I love boat talk. In fact, I was telling Phyllis, I want to live on a boat, but she won't. She won't do it. She likes the trees. But, you know, we could always float down there and look at trees, you know. Hard to miss. Now, do you understand what I'm saying here? I mean, I might not be so far off. It sounds really new and fresh, but staros can mean stake, pole, staff, mast, upright wood. And when you're looking at those old pictures of these boats or go to the museum, you see that the way that they capture the wind power is they put their pole up and then they put their sail up. The first thing they have to do is put the pole up. They can't put the sail up until the mast is up. You know. So, and when they want to park the boat, if they leave the mast up, well, something might happen in the middle of the night, you know. Like, where'd it go? You know. It's like those basketball things that are portable that people put in their yards. Where'd it go? You know, when the wind blows. So the Greek word aero is an idiom for sail away or weigh anchor. I mean, these nautical dudes knew what he was talking about. Like, get your boat ready, you know. Lift it up, raise the mast, and follow me, you know. So it's like following a fisherman, going out to fish, you know. I have fun with George Soros. He's got a real expressive face. Now, what about this crossing of fingers? Well, crossing fingers was a way that people would hold their hand behind their back and hope to ward off an evil eye. Or in Wikipedia, it explains this. In early European cultures, two people were required to use their index fingers to form the sign, one to make a wish and the other to support it. So it took two people. It was believed that the cross was a symbol of unity and that benign spirits, in other words, pagan demons, were dwelling at the intersecting point. A wish on a cross was a figurative way of securing the wish at the intersection until it came true. Over the years, the custom was modified so one person could make a wish on his or her own. Now, it's all witchery all the time, you know. Now, here's this image that was similar to what Ezekiel saw, or Yehezkel saw. And it's in chapter 8, if you want to read about it. And they're also talking about weeping for Tammuz in that same chapter. I want to just bring that up. I didn't put it on here, but in chapter 8, Tammuz worship is mentioned. It's an abomination. Well, this object is right there at the entrance where St. Peter's is today. The signing of your body was adopted. The earliest fathers of the corpse mentioned this custom as it was originated with the apostles. They say the apostles originated this. Tertullian in AD 160 urges the Christians to make the sign of the crux or cross when coming in and going out, when dressing or at table, in their rooms and sitting down in every undertaking. Well, that sounds amazingly like what we read earlier in the seminar about how we're supposed to think of the Torah, these commandments, when we come in and when we go out and when we rise up. Well, St. Ephrem in AD 378 writes this, arm thyself with the sign of the cross as with a shield. Sign thy members and thy heart, but sign thyself not only with thy hand, but with thy mind. Thy work, thy coming in and thy going out, thy bed and the ground over which thou dost pass, sign everything in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, for these are the strongest weapons. We do not want to receive the sign of the image of the beast. Instead of man's sign inherited from the dragon, the sign upon our hand is this. Deuteronomy 6, and these words which I command you this day shall be in your heart. And you shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise up. And you shall bind them for a sign upon thy hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes, and you shall write them upon the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. He left out anything referring to a cross. That would have been known in those days, though. You know, the cross was a symbol of paganism. Now, the totem pole is an object that is revered, and it represents a guardian, an ancestor, a clan emblem, or an object used as a badge or a sign of a tribe. Christians are called a tribe. Well, what would this look like? Again, I mean, when you look at these side by side, you see what it is, you know. Now, Yeshayahu 44 says he cuts down cedars for himself and he takes cypress and oak, which he raised among the trees of the forest. And he's planted a pine and the rain nourishes it. And it shall be for a man to burn, and he takes some of it and warms himself. He also kindles it and shall bake bread. He also makes a mighty one and bows himself to it. And he's made a carved image and falls down before it. Half of it he burns in the fire, and with this half he eats meat. He roasts a roast and is satisfied, and also warms himself and says, aha, I am warm, I have seen the fire. And the rest of it he makes into a mighty one, his carved image. He falls down before it and worships and prays to it and says, deliver me, for you are my mighty one. They do not know nor understand, for he has smeared their eyes from seeing and their hearts from understanding, and no one recalls it to his heart, nor is there knowledge nor understanding to say, I have burned half of it in the fire, and I have also baked bread on its coals. I have roasted meat and eaten it. And shall I make the rest of it an abomination? Should I fall down before a log of wood? Feeding on ashes, a deceived heart turns him aside, and he does not deliver his being. Nor does he say, is there not a lie in my right hand? Branded. I mean, big time. Anyway, this is really strange looking, but these are humans. These are not aliens. These are not children. These are adults that are completely brainwashed. Note the crooks, but also notice the monstrans. And they're bowing down before the host. And notice the obelisk shape to the whole architecture. And you see that in the windows too, but that's what the steeple is too. But when we bow to any image, when we do this, there's two things at least that are happening, besides the offense, that we're breaking our Creator's heart. But we're bowing down before an image, so we defile ourselves. We're defiled. The object becomes an abomination. And the land is defiled as well. And that's why people are being vomited out. Revelation 13 says, and he leads astray those who dwell on the earth because of those signs which he has given to do before the beast, saying to those dwelling on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword yet lived. Who was it that was wounded by the sword and yet lived? Well, it was Tammuz. He was wounded by the sword of a boar. He was gored to death. And yet he lives. You know, this is a very strange anti-Messiah version. But the signs can be also interpreted as the sacraments too. The sacraments don't exist, but they're made up as a means for salvation. They're not scriptural. They're just made up. The beast is the pattern of Babel. The image is of course, the physical image is the obelisk and the crooks, but it's also become the wafer deity because they're worshiping that, and of course the sun disk and the cross on top of it. But the monstrance was actually designed for worship. That's what it was designed for. And here's a little wormwood that we dealt with last month, but it's showing them bowing and kneeling before an image of the Roman pontiff too. She's no doubt mumbling to this lifeless picture, praying to this picture, kneeling before it. And then here's a woman over here kneeling down to receive the host. And here's the monstrance that's designed for the worship of the host. Remember, he said he's given them over to worship the host of heaven. And what is that object? Isn't that a sun? You know, and Tammuz's name is associated with it. And the sign of the cross is an emblem of the sun. Well, it's a violation of command number 2. Exodus 20 says, you do not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of which is in the heavens above or which is in the earth beneath or which is in the waters under the earth. You do not bow down to them nor serve them. For I, Yahuwah, your Elohim, am a jealous El, visiting the crookedness of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing kindness to thousands to those who love me and guard my commands. Say hello to my little stronghold. I'm not trying to make fun of these people. I'm just saying this is a little bit scary for me to even present this to you because I know that people love this and it's a stronghold. And you don't want to go out bashing people and just flippantly saying, that's pagan. You have to carefully guide them and explain this to them, okay? You guys are, for the most part, very well coached. Revelation 17, and the woman, which is a religion, was dressed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, holding in her hand a golden cup filled with abominations and the filthiness of her whoring, and upon her forehead a name written, a secret, Babel the Great, the mother of the whores and of the abominations of the earth. And Jeremiah, or Yirmiyahu 51, says, Babel was a golden cup in the hand of Yahuwah, making drunk all the earth. The nations drank her wine, and that is why the nations went mad. And there was given to him to give spirit to the image of the beast. And the image of the beast, that the image of the beast, should both speak and cause to be killed as many as would not worship the image of the beast. You notice that. They would not worship it, so they were killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, and free and slave, to be given a mark upon their right hand or upon their foreheads, and that no one should be able to buy or sell except he that has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Now, Sunday is, by their own definition, is this. Sunday is our mark of authority. The corpse is above the B-I-B-L-E, and this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact. Of course, I modified that one word, but it's worshiping of the wrong things at the wrong times. The Catholic Record, this was published in 1923, what I just said. Now, the image of jealousy is still right in front of people's eyes, right there in Rome, Italy. It's right in the middle of the entrance. And interestingly enough, when they don't worship this host, there was a time when Rome was so powerful that they would actually kill people because they would not believe that that object that they were bowing down to was the physical presence of the body of the Messiah. Okay? That's why it's interesting that Revelation said that. And Constantine's creed is very revealing as well. This is their kind of wormwood. I renounce all customs, rites, legalisms, unleavened breads, and sacrifices of lambs of the Hebrews, and all the other feasts of the Hebrews, sacrifices, prayers, aspirations, purifications, sanctifications, and propitiations, and fasts, and new moons, and Sabbaths, and superstitions, and hymns, and chants, and observances, and synagogues. Absolutely everything Jewish, every law, rite, and custom. And if afterwards I shall wish to deny and return to Jewish superstition, or shall be found eating with Jews, or feasting with them, or secretly conversing and condemning the Christian religion, instead of openly confuting them and condemning their vain faith, then let the trembling of Cain and leprosy of Gehazi cleave to me, as well as the legal punishments to which I acknowledge myself liable. And may I be an anathema in the world to come, and may my soul be set down with Satan and the devils. Well, oddly enough, all these things that they're making them turn away from are the redemption plan. And all these things that they're adding are the reason that they will be sitting down with Satan and the devils. You know? Now, the image of the beast is more than just the object. You know, it's the framework. It's the pattern. It's the abstract level. You know, the image of the beast that we mentioned earlier about Daniel's vision that he was explaining in the dream. So anyway, the image is any guise or form or shape or effigy or model or design or figure or facade, outline, any kind of pattern like that. Anyway, there's a sophisticated religious architecture, but it's physical and it's abstract. So this architecture, it has really taken over the whole world. It's a powerful form of worship with rituals, symbols, and it's overseen by the world rulers of darkness. Now, these spiritual beings are behind all this stuff, and they maintain the living organism Yahuwah calls Babel. And it's an image, it has its image and it has its mark. The image is the solar cross with this obelisk too, and it is also Sunday. You know, Matthew 24 says this, and this good news message of the reign shall be proclaimed in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end shall come. So when you see the abomination that lays waste, spoken of by Daniel, the prophet, set up in the set apart place, he who reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Yehuda flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not come down to take whatever out of his house. And let him who is in the field not turn back to get his garments. And woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing children in those days. And pray that your flight does not take place in winter or on a Sabbath. So, you know, we have to be careful about that. So if you ever see one of these objects raised up in the land of Israel, or particularly Jerusalem, then that's a signal that you need to get out of there. Now, what do these objects have in common? You see these pictures here. The pillar of jealousy, and it's at the entrance. That's where they put them. There's that similarity. And you have these wooden A-S-H-E-R-I-M, you know. There's all kinds of them there. There's a M-A-Y pole. There's some people here in ancient times worshiping these columns with objects on top of them. Because, see, at the very top of the column, they would put their deity, you know. So the pagan pattern from Babel was also inherited and propagated by Gaius Octavius. We talked about Augustus Caesar before. He installed a bell in the tower at the entrance to the tower of J-U-P-I-T-E-R. And it's the image of jealousy. It's not hard to find this thing. I mean, it's huge. And they've inherited it all the way from Babylon. It started there. Babel, Egypt, Greece, Rome. And now there's one in Washington, D.C. Everybody knows about the Washington Monument. You know, the Masons are obviously some sort of form of warlock knights, you know, propagating this stuff.
The Washington Monument is, what, 6,660 inches tall?
Yeah. So the Sumerian Kreuks, the image of this deity they call Shamash, and there it is, it's a picture of it. In Luke 2, 1, we read this, and it came to be in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus for all the world to be registered. Now this deity right here that they call Peter was the object that this fellow, Augustus Caesar, bowed himself to. Now, we are to wear Yahuwah's armor. Ephesians 6 tells us to put on the whole armor of Elohim for you to have power to stand against the schemes of the devil. Because we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against authorities, against the world rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual wickedness in the heavenlies. So our adversaries are not really physical. Because of this, take up the complete armor of Elohim. Like, remember when little Daoud put on the armor of Shaul? Well, he said, I can't wear that. It's made by human hands. That won't help you. You need Yahuwah's armor. So then, anyway, we put it on so that you have power to withstand the wicked day, and having done all, to stand. Stand then, having girded your waist with truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having fitted your feet with the preparation of the good news of peace. Above all, having taken up the shield of belief, with which you shall have power to quench all the burning arrows of the wicked one. Take also the helmet of deliverance and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of Elohim, praying at all times, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, watching in all perseverance and supplication for all the set apart ones. Also for me, that a word might be given to me in the opening of my mouth, to be bold in making known the secret of the good news, for which I am an envoy in chains, that in it I might speak boldly, as I should speak. And you should see also 2 Corinthians 10, verse 4. Now we're instructed to expose them. Ephesians 5 says this, let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these the wrath of Elohim comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore do not become partakers with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Master. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is well-pleasing to the Master. And have no fellowship with the fruitless works of darkness, but rather expose them. So the mark of Tammuz is definitely being exposed. I don't know, you have to be gentle with people. So they're deceived when they're young, and then they grow old and they have the same error. Here's Nancy and Harry over here too. They're a couple of really nice Catholic people.
It's Joe Byron.
Oh, is it? It's Joe? Okay, I have that wrong, that labeled wrong. So here's an image of Tammuz. Over here on the left, we see that he was born on December 25th. He was resurrected on EASTER morning. He breaks Torah, and he allows followers to ignore Torah. And he's a living testimony to all things of Babel's sun cultures. And he declares the Sabbath has moved to Sunday. And the primary symbol of this deity is the solar cross. Now, the real Messiah was born at Sukkoth. His name is Yahusha. He was resurrected on the day of first fruits because he is the first fruits. And he promotes obedience to the Torah. I mean, he's the only rabbi there is. You know, he teaches Torah. What would a rabbi teach if he didn't teach Torah? No association at all with sun cultures. And he told us to pray that our flight not be in winter or on a Sabbath. And he acknowledged the Sabbath day. He wasn't like one of these lunar people that was going, well, you all have the wrong cycle going on. He recognized the same day as the Sabbath. The primary symbol, the menorah. He was pictured, you know, in the first chapter of Revelation, amid seven golden lampstands. What would that be? One is an identity thief, an anti-Messiah, one in place of. That's what anti means, one who is in place of. Or against, but mostly one who is in place of the other. A usurper, an imitator, someone who wants to be like Yahuwah. And his image is an abomination in our Creator's eyes. So what is the sign that we hold forever? It's the seventh day. It commemorates creation. Exodus 31, verses 16 and 17, and the children of Israel shall guard the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. Between me and the children of Israel, it is a sign forever. For in 6 days, Yahuwah made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. See also Deuteronomy 28, verse 46. Ezekiel 20, verse 10. So I took them out of the land of Mitzrayim, and I brought them into the wilderness, and I gave them my laws and showed them my right rulings, which if a man does, he shall live by them. And I also gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me, between them and me, to know that I am Yahuwah who sets them apart. And then continuing in verse 19, it says, I am Yahuwah, your Elohim. Walk in my laws and guard my right rulings and do them and set apart my Sabbaths. And they shall be a sign between me and you to know that I am Yahuwah your Elohim. See also Yeshayahu or Isaiah chapter 56. In Matthew or Matthew 13, it says, because of this I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Now here's our commission, okay? It's our orders to teach righteousness. Okay, Matthew 28 says, therefore go and make taught ones of all the nations, immersing them in the name, not three names, the name of the Father and the Son and the set apart Spirit, teaching them to guard all that I have commanded you. Okay. And see, I am with you always until the end of the age. That's the same thing he told Moshe's successor. I like that. The Nazarim are the guardians of the name and the Torah. That's what we do. We love it. He wrote it on our hearts. That's what happened in Acts chapter 2. You know, it was an anniversary. It's coming up next weekend, actually. Is it? Yeah. Next weekend is Shavuot, which they call Pentecost. But that is the wedding anniversary from Sinai. At Sinai, Israel married Yahuwah, became his wife, his bride. And the bridegroom, is scattered us all over the nations, and now he's going to regather us. Yes?
Shavuot, that's a commanded gathering, right? right?
Yeah, yeah, it is.
About 3 times a year.
Right. We're supposed to get together. And anyone that wants to come here, that's fine. Of course, we are scattered. We're in captivity over here. But we should, wherever two or three are gathered in his name, he is there, okay? So if you can't make it, just get with someone else. Two or three, you know. So Baruch Haba B'Shem Yahuwah, blessed is the one who comes in the name of Yahuwah. He said he wouldn't come back until we started to say that. He said, we're the salt of the earth, but if the salt becomes tasteless, how shall it be seasoned? For it is no longer of any use but to be thrown out and trodden down by men. So we're to preserve and guard the name and the Torah. So that's all I have today on that subject. But does everybody understand the two levels of the abstract level of the beast? And that's the pattern, you know, that was shown in the dream. And then the physical objects are there too. So we've adopted the wrong things. And we shouldn't adopt anything, actually, except the truth, you know. Yes, sir?
The Father, the Son, and the set apart spirit. You said that was two. Isn't that three? How did you get two out of that?
Well, it's really all one, you know.
I understand it's all one, but it's either one or three. I mean, the way it was up on the screen, one.
Oh.
On the screen, it said the Father, the Son, and the set apart spirit, which would be...
Yeah.
Representing three on the spirit.
Well, yes, he said that the name, it was a singular word, not names, but the singular name, and there's only one name given under heaven among men by which we must be saved. That's Acts 4:12. And that he's only one being, and his, I know that people want to think of him as a three manifesting entity, but he's really only one being, but it says that that Yahuwah is our deliverer. There is no other deliverer but Yahuwah. And when Philip came to Yahusha with his disciples and he was asking him to show us the Father, he said, Philip, have I been with you so long and you haven't recognized me? He who has seen me has seen the Father, you know. And at some point, Philip thereafter fell down, Thomas fell down, and after having seen the wounds and knowing that he had died and was now walking the earth, he said he fell down on his knees and said, my sovereign and my Elohim. He fell down and worshiped Yahusha. Now, we cannot worship an angel or a messenger or a Malachim. We can only worship one, and that would be Yahusha himself. He's manifesting Yahuwah in the flesh. He's the physical presence, and all the fullness of deity dwelled in him and dwells now in him. It's not like he's one third, or, you know, as the Christians would say. I know that that's a stronghold too. That's another stronghold is what it is. The Trinity is not taught in the scriptures. That's something that was brought in when people began to study the doctrine of immersion under the Catholic understanding. You know, because they took it from that same text to immerse them in the name of the Father and the Son and the set apart spirit. See, he's not saying that he's not pointing to that. He's pointing to the name. Immerse them in the name. So you have to teach them the name. Now, if I was standing up here not saying the name out loud, these walls would not ever hear the name, as they don't down the street. There's tens of thousands of people down the street, and those walls have never heard the name Yahuwah spoken within them that I know of. But even if it were, most of them wouldn't accept it. So you have to immerse them in the name. And of course, that's metaphoric and physical. People have to go to the water for redemption. That's the way that's your entry point into the tribe of Israel, into the tribes of Israel. Your entry point to become an Israelite, to re-engraft as a broken off branch, is to enter the water. And that's a sign of your circumcision. And that's where your heart receives the Torah. That's when he comes in and writes a love for his Torah upon your heart, instead of in stone tablets. And then you come up out of the water and he goes, oh, what's this? Something new. You disappeared for a moment. In fact, you died. You went under the water. That's a death. And then you come back up. Oh, what's this? Oh, that's a new Israelite. That's something brand new. Everything before is not thought of. And that's why the sins that you did before, that you were not committed to the covenant at that time, are all gone in his eyes. Washed away by the blood that has been sprinkled on your heart. The blood of the Messiah sprinkled on your heart is what cleanses you. And almost every day I pray to him to cleanse me from the inside. And the only thing that can do that is his blood. You know, of course it's been done, but I still ask him to wash me, you know, because he's forever operating as our high priest. That's what he does. Wherever he is right now, that's what he's doing, you know, continually making offerings for us. He doesn't even sleep. He doesn't ever close his eyes and say, well, let me just take that off my mind for a moment. He never forgets us. He's inscribed our names on the palms of his hands. The priesthood, I don't think, gets a rest, you know, but I think he's constantly doing. He's continually working as our high priest.
Welcome to the circus.